you would, take your Bible, turn with me to the book of Matthew. You know, we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, and then we've made it past there. It's amazing if you really get that good understanding of that focal verse where that our righteousness must exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. Back over in chapter 5, verse 20 of the book of Matthew, then once you start wrapping your mind around that and realize it's not a superficial outward thing, it's something from the inside, and then once again, you're going to see that tonight. When we get so focused on the superficial outside, I thought of so many illustrations. And I think about this often, especially studying over this passage and thinking on these things. You know, you go through here, and as you go through these passages, I think to myself, how do I do that? How do we as a church body do this? How is it that I cannot do that? Sometimes there's things that I tell myself I don't do, but I catch myself doing it. And I realize, oh, man, I do that. I actually do that. It's an amazing thing how, if you ever got around somebody that constantly does things, like they might constantly do this. And they'll grab their right earlobe all the time. And you're watching them and you're thinking, why do you do that? And you might even ask the question, is your ear hurting? No, why? And they don't even realize they're doing it. They're just habitually doing that. I've got this fellow that I work around, and literally, he's not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but you know, he'll ask questions, and then his question might be, you know, what's the square root of some number? And if I was to say, well, it's 126.6725, that's what I thought. That's what he'll say every time. You know, how long is that right there? Well, I'll know because I just measured it. And I'm like 32 foot. That's what I thought. And I'm like, man, you didn't know that. How in the world did you? But it's a habitual thing. And it's funny that once that somebody brings that to your attention, you get self-conscious about it. And you'll think, and you'll start catching yourself. You keep catching yourself. Well, I think that's the way the Word of God, when we read and study Scripture, what the Lord Jesus is trying to teach us, He's trying to teach us these things that we shouldn't do. All right? And as He teaches us these things that we shouldn't do, then once He identifies that, as we go through our life, then immediately it should be something that constantly keeps coming up, and we're like, ooh, I did it again. Ooh, I did it again. And it's because the Word of God has made that clear to us, all right? Just like I've had some folks come to me before, and I'm not even going to tell you what they are, but they've said, why do you always do that? And I'm like, do what? And then they would do it, they would demonstrate to me, because they had watched me and I did it. It was habitually because it was a habit. And whenever that they identified that to me, oh my goodness, it messed with me. Because every time I would do that thing that I'm not doing right now, all right? Every time I would do that thing, it would really get me. And I'm thinking, I can't believe I did that again and again and again. And I would have to literally, it would eat at me so bad, I would have to mentally just concentrate on not doing that thing because I didn't want to be in that repetitious little habit thing. Well, once again, the Scriptures identifies to us, these are the things that you should be doing. These are the things you shouldn't be doing. And once I realize, you see, the problem comes, and we'll get to the text in just a second because this all fits with it. All right? The problem comes is when I think, well, I don't do that. It's an amazing thing to me. Most of you are familiar with football. And football now, I don't know if they do it. I don't watch pro ball. But in college football, if they have made a call, if the refs have made a call, they can throw this red flag or whatever, and it gets identified for a replay. They'll go do a replay to see if they can see if the ref made the right call or not. All right. And in this particular, these commercials that's been coming on, somebody will say, "Well, I told you to do that." "No, you didn't." "Oh, yes, I did." And they'll throw that red flag, and they'll go back and look at the video monitor, and then the person is saying, "No, you didn't," walks away and saying, "Okay, I'll go get it." That's the way we do the Lord. We literally, He's trying to explain to us, here's where you're at, here's what you're doing. And we literally, if we don't just admit to Him that, "You know what, Lord? You're right. I do that all the time. I shouldn't be doing that." If we don't ever come to that point of admittance, you're never going to change. Why? Because you're going to think, "I'm good. I don't do that. There's nothing I need to change for." It's kind of like Barney on Andy Griffin. And, you know, they were singing in the choir and somebody was out of tune. And Andy said, and Barney said, "Well, we need to find him and get him out of here." But he was the guy.
Yeah.
And it's easy for us to get into that thing that when you read through Scripture and you think, "Well, that's not me. I know the Lord's not talking about me because I don't ever do that." But literally, if the Lord could throw a red flag and let us look into what He sees, we would realize, man, I do that. This particular instance, there's a man named Matthew, which is this book that God allowed this particular apostle to pin these things down. God spoke it. Matthew just wrote it down. That's very important. And I've shared that so many times. Whenever the Scriptures teaches us and it says this, a lot of times you'll hear evangelists or pastors and they'll say, "Well, Matthew said," or "Paul said." No, they didn't. Because if Paul literally from his intellect wrote it down, then it's not from God. God spoke it. They wrote it down. There's a big difference there.
Amen.
Matthew pinned this down. This is the beginning of Matthew's ministry. Look at chapter 9, verse 9. Chapter 9 of the Gospel of Matthew. I'm sorry, I should have told you earlier. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, verse 9. Just a few verses here. And I'm including verse 9 in with 9 through 13 here. Most of you probably has some type of an indent that shows a paragraph there. Verse 9, "And as Jesus passed from thence, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the receipt of custom, and he saith unto him, Follow me. And he arose and followed him." Isn't it an amazing thing? Do you think if he's sitting at the receipt of custom, and Jesus had to pass by and just looked at him and kept walking, do you think he would have got up and followed him?
No.
Praise God that we've got a song in our hymnal that says, "Jesus spoke to me one day. Praise his holy name. Said he died my debt to pay. Bore my sin and shame." Yep. I'm telling you, I'm glad that he spoke to me.
Amen.
And the reason being is because literally, I didn't audibly hear him, but boy, I sure know that it was just like he had a hold of me, drawing me to himself. That is an amazing thing.
Amen.
And I believe that right here, Matthew is there. Jesus done knew before the foundation of the world, according to Ephesians 1:4. He knew that as he was coming by, he was going to look at Matthew and say, "Matthew, come follow me." Matthew had a decision. I'm either going to follow him or I'm staying at the receipt of custom. But Scripture says, once the Lord Jesus spoke to him, he arose and followed him. So a couple of questions just from this verse that we literally could look at ourselves and say, okay, now how do I apply that to me? Here's the first question. Has Jesus spoke to you and drew you to himself? Has there been a time that he's knocked on your heart's door and you knew he was speaking to you and you've rejected him and you've never put your faith in the finished work of Jesus? But you know he spoke to you. You know he's convicted you. You know for a fact that he's drawn you and maybe even have put somebody in your path to give you the gospel and teach you that the blood of Jesus paid the sin debt for your sins. And that he died on the old rugged cross to nail our sins there and he was placed in a barred tomb and rose again the third day. And yet we have rejected that draw. So the first question is, has Jesus spoke to me? If we and some of you say yes, but I didn't follow him. I didn't follow him in the respect of trusting Jesus as my Savior. I literally think maybe if I've talked to folks before, do you know that you're saved? And they're like, well, no. And I'm like, well, if you died right now, where do you think you'd go? And they'd say, well, I guess, according to what you're saying, I'd go to hell. And I'm like, well, why would you not want to believe in the Lord Jesus so that you don't have to go to this horrible place? I'm just not ready. All right. So that's one thing. So you've heard him speak, you know the gospel, and you felt that drawing power, but you pushed him away. The second response is, we heard this. We heard, and we know the Lord drew us, and we know the Lord had presented the gospel, and we did put our faith and trust in him. And it's just like that door. Literally, we can step in the door, put our backs up against it, and never walk another step. And I feel like for years of my life, that's where I stayed. I didn't grow. I wasn't following him. I wasn't doing what Matthew did. Matthew immediately, he followed him. I didn't. I believed who he was. I knew. I asked him to save me. I prayed and said, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. I want to be born again. And I believe he saved me that day. But I stepped inside a door with my back against it, and I didn't do the second part of this verse, which is follow him. So, number one tonight, I want you to ask this question. Has Jesus spoke to me and I've rejected him? If you have, here's your chance. You don't have to reject him tonight. You can get that settled. Whether you're watching via Facebook or here. Number two, if you have believed on the Lord Jesus, are you following? Here's the thing. Either we're standing with our back against the door like I did for years, or we're doing what Matthew did. What's the verdict? And it's not up for me to go and do this, or for you to say this. It's for us to do a self-examination.
Amen.
And say, Lord, I know what condition I'm in. You see, it's like I was sharing a minute ago. A lot of times people can say, oh, you're not following him. Yes, I am. You know you're not. Well, why not? Well, you see, it's not up for the other folks to decide whether I'm following him. We know whether or not we're following him.
Amen.
And the question is, if we put our faith in the Lord Jesus, he saved us so that he could have a relationship with us. He saved us so that we could talk to him and he could fellowship with us. And if we're not following him, then we can't have that. I want you to just get that. That's just that one verse. Matthew's drawn and he follows him. So much can be brought from that. I just wanted you to think about those two things. Verse 10, and it came to pass as Jesus sat at meat in the house, behold, many publicans, that's a tax collector, one that went to get revenue and pull revenue in, like Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and he was a tax collector. So that's a publican. Nobody liked publicans. Publicans were bad people, and here's why. Because they would carry around something like this, and usually it was a false balance. And where you thought they would have it set up to where you were given a whole lot more than what you really owed, because it might have had a 2 wrote on it, but it was really 10. And you had to put 10 pounds worth of money on it, even though that it said 2. And they were crooked. People knew they were crooked. And because people knew they were crooked, then they didn't like them. And they were esteemed as they were crooked. Matter of fact, they are so crooked that God even separates the name. Publicans and sinners. Yep. Now, what's a sinner? That's a good question, is it not? What is a sinner in this respect? In this respect, he says, Jesus is sitting in the house. Behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down and with him and his disciples. What was a sinner? Did they not look right? Did they not have the right type of lingo? Maybe they didn't have the polysyllabic presentation that they needed. Maybe they didn't have enough money. Maybe they didn't have a fancy enough shirt. Well, wait a minute. They wore tunics. And so what made them a sinner? Well, maybe they were adulterers and they were known. Maybe they were thieves and they were known. Maybe they were habitual liars and people knew it. Whatever it was, a sinner is somebody literally, and that's all of us, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. A sinner, in order for them to identify this, is somebody that didn't identify themselves with the righteousness of God in Christ, and it was something that they had about them that was identified. Maybe they had committed some crime and they were felt guilty and they were esteemed sinners. Maybe it was a sense that, like I shared a minute ago, maybe they were habitual liars and people just knew they were habitual liars. Maybe it was like the woman caught in adultery that was thrown at the feet of Jesus. Maybe, I don't know, but whatever it was, in order for Scripture to identify that they were sinners, here's the definition of sin. Now, this is really important, so you got to get this. The definition of sin literally is disobedience to God's word. Four words to define S-I-N. What is sin? Disobedience to God's word. What is a sin? All right? A sin, you see, you wouldn't think that eating a piece of fruit was a sin. But yet, for as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death had passed on all men for all of sin. And it all started because Adam and Eve ate a piece of fruit. Is that not amazing? Is it not unbelievable? You know why that eating of the tree of knowledge and good and evil was wrong?
Disobedient to God.
Because God said not to. God said, don't do this. It wasn't the fact that the fruit wasn't good. It wasn't even the fact that it wouldn't make them wise, actually. It made them wise unto their condition or their situation they were in. But the important thing is, God said, don't do it. Anything that He says not to do, even if it's eating a particular fruit, and we do it, it's called sin. So in order for the Bible to teach us right here, in order for the Bible to teach us that sinners came, literally they had to have some evidence that something written in the Scriptures they had broken. Maybe they were trying to judge them by the law. Man, if you've ever... Go back to Leviticus and Deuteronomy. Go just read through the book of Leviticus.
Yeah.
Oh, son, you don't have to go looking far. You can only take so many steps in a day, on the Sabbath day. You can only go so far. Oh, my goodness, I'm not even going there. But it's just an amazing thing. How many things... Maybe... Obviously, they say that the Gospel of Matthew was written to the Jews. So if it was the Jews, literally, they were going by the Old Testament law. And they knew that these people, they didn't keep the Sabbath day. They knew that these people, they made into themselves graven images, second commandment. They knew that this group of people were disobeying and disobedient and unruly and did not follow God. And therefore, they were esteemed sinners. Look at the rest of it. Jesus is sitting here, it came to pass. Jesus sat at meat in the house. Behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. Now listen, here's what the religious people of the day didn't do. There's no way they would be caught eating with no tax collector. And the other thing they wouldn't be doing is... there's no way that they're going to be caught sitting down at a table with a sinner known sinner that disobeys the word of God. But where do we find our Savior sitting? Right there in the middle of them. Now, this modern day contemporary gospel, I call it, you know, river sound and autumn breeze and mountain laurel and all these other places they call a church that ain't even got a name on it except for some nature name, you know, Rippling Brook, and I could go on and on. All right, that the contemporary gospel says that, look, Jesus became as one of them so that he could reach them. That's the furthest from this scripture right here that you'll ever get. Jesus was God, and he came to save them from their sin. And if he came to save us from our sin, if you get saved from your sin, guess what? You're not anymore.
A sinner.
Yep. And because of that, that's why 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if you're in Christ, old things are passed away. But you've got to go to where sinners are. Listen, if you're going to catch a big fish, you got to go where big fish are. You know, I love when, you know, whenever they would start, you know, the bass would start running and schooling. Man, you could go out there and catch a pile of those little bitty ones. Man, that was fun. But if you go where the little schooling fish are, you ain't going to catch a biggie. If you're going to lead somebody to Christ, you got to go to somewhere that they say, yeah, I'm a sinner. What about it? Because they are the ones that need the gospel. Jesus is sitting at the table with them. Look at the next verse, verse 11. And when the Pharisees saw it, the Pharisees were the religious rulers of the day. They were the religious politicians of the day, I like saying. They saw it, and they said unto his disciples, why eateth your master with publicans and sinners? Why, thee help my time. I want you to look yonder. What's he thinking? What is he doing, Brother Jim? Yeah. He's eating with sinners and publicans. Why? There's no way that our rabbis would allow that. So they're just beside themselves. Now, up into this point, oh my goodness, at the miracles he's done and at the people he's healed and at the lives he's already changed and at the demons he's cast out and all these things that's happened. But then all of a sudden, Jesus heard that. He heard it. And do you realize there's nothing that we say
that he don't hear? That's right.
Billy and I were talking today, and he was like, well, you know, I wasn't trying to, but I heard this person say this thing. Well, let me share this with you. There ain't a one of us in here. Not a one of us. If you went back to my office and when you passed by the office, you heard somebody say, well, I tell you what, that old Jeff Brown sits up right on the front row, and they start saying something about you, immediately your attitude changes toward that person. And you're thinking, I can't believe they said that. And then right afterwards you see them, good morning, brother, how you doing? and you're thinking, now, I just heard you running me down back there. Now, think about this. Here's why I share this. Because if Jesus hears everything we say,
And he does,
and everything we say doesn't glorify him, ain't you glad that whenever that we say something that doesn't glorify him, that he don't get as upset as we would if we heard somebody talking about us?
Yeah.
Amen. My goodness. And I'm telling you, we might think to ourselves, well, I don't do that. Oh, my goodness. Church, there's so many ways. Matter of fact, you could go back to the book of Hosea. Miss Leanne used to sing a song about Hosea. Hosea was told to go and marry a prostitute. You know why? That was a picture of the New Testament happening, that Jesus was going to come marry somebody that cheated on him all the time. Do you know in the book of James chapter 4 it says, ye adulterers and adulteresses, Know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity against God, and whosoever shall be a friend of the world is the enemy of God? Yep. Do you realize when we friend up with the world system, we're literally his enemy? We're cheating on him. He married us. We weren't worthy to be married. I was a sinner. On my best day, I was a sinner. On my worst day, I was a sinner. And he still saved me.
Amen.
And yet now, here I am going and cheating on him with the world. But he still loves me. What an amazing thing. Now, Jesus heard this. And immediately, here's the direction that he gave. Look at verse 12. He says, "But when Jesus heard that, he said unto them, They that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick." Immediately, he says, listen. He gives them an illustration of exactly why he's sitting at the table he's sitting at. It isn't because I like beer too. Give me another, bartender. And you try to justify being around that group. It isn't because of any other thing except for the fact that he knew their circumstance. He knew their situation. And they're the ones that needs healed. But it wasn't physical. It was spiritual.
Yeah.
They were the ones that needed help. But it was physical or spiritual, not financial. They were the ones that needed an understanding. But it wasn't mental. It was spiritual. Every bit of it. That was his sole purpose. Sole purpose. So he gives this illustration. And immediately verse 13 follows and says, "But go ye and learn what that meaneth." Notice right there, there's a comma. He says, "They that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. But go ye and learn what that meaneth." Go figure that one out, is what he says. Because he knows when he said that to them, they're thinking, what is he trying to say? And then he gives the rest of this parish passage. He says, "I will have mercy and not sacrifice." There's three passages that if you'll hold your place, we'll go back and look at. Proverbs 21 is one of them. Proverbs 21, and I think probably Proverbs 21, verse 3. It says, "To do justice and judgment is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice." The second one is in Hosea chapter 6, verse number 6. Hosea, Joel. So if you'll find Joel, that's one of the biggest books. And Amos, Ann, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum. So it's in the latter part of your Old Testament, if you're having problems finding that one. Hosea, Joel. And when we get to the book of Joel, or I'm sorry, Hosea chapter 6. Hosea chapter 6. You need to read that. That's a hard book to read, but man, I'm telling you, if you go in it with an understanding of what's going on, it's pretty awesome. Hosea chapter 6. Listen what he says. Starting in verse 6. It says, "For I desired mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." All right. So we've got those two verses. Now go to Micah chapter 6 and we'll complete this thought. Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, the end. So back about seven books from the end of the Old Testament, a little book called Micah. All right, and as we go to Micah, there's only seven chapters. You go to chapter 6, and I want you to look at chapter 6, or verse 6. Listen to what he says. "Wherewith shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God?" Notice that's a question. "Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old?" Question. "Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams or with 10,000s of rivers of oil?" That's a question. "Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression or for my law breaking, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul?" Question mark. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good. And what doth the Lord require of thee but to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with thy God? That is a question, but that was the latter question of saying, here's what he requires. Here's what he desires. Here's what he focuses on. And because of that, we'll go back over to the verse 13. He says, I will have mercy and not sacrifice. He's not desiring sacrifice. He's literally willing to have mercy. You know what mercy is? Mercy is not giving you what you do deserve. Do those sinners and publicans deserve judgment? Yes. But he's willing to give mercy because, the latter part, I'm not come to call the righteous but sinners to repentance. Guess what? There's a twofold meaning of that. Alright? After you're born again, go with me to the Gospel of John and we'll wrap up right here. The Gospel of John, go to chapter 3. Very familiar, most probably most memorized verse in all of Scripture. And I'm telling you, we miss it. We miss it. Here's why. Because when we look at this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. When Jesus walked on the earth, he sat with publicans and sinners. As he sat with publicans and sinners, it isn't so he can hang out with them. It isn't so he can fit in with the crowd. It isn't so he can hang out with the in crowd. It's because he knew they needed a physician. And he was the one that could heal them. Amen. And therefore, we see in chapter 3:16, he says, look, if they would put their faith in me, they could be saved. They could be broke, their chains broken. They could be healed from their sin condition. Verse 17, chapter 3 of the Gospel of John. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. You know why Jesus is sent with publicans and sinners? Because he didn't come to condemn them. All of us are sinners. He could have went and sat at the Pharisees' table. You know why? Because they were sinners. He could have went and sat at anybody's table. But these ones that were esteemed sinners, and these publicans, he went and sat down because he knew they're sick. They need help. And I didn't come into the world to condemn them. I come into the world to save them.
Amen.
Look at the next verse. I love it. Verse 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned. I heard Brother John MacArthur this week preach on Romans 8:1. Oh my goodness. Here's the big nugget that stuck out with me, Brother Walton. People think, back in 1961, I got saved at such and such a clock on this day. Well, that's great. Well, when I got saved, they think, I wasn't condemned. Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. All right? Well, guess what? Once you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, you're no longer condemned. There is no more condemnation to you. None. The word condemnation is a judicial word. In other words, it was a word, condemnation toward somebody that's in court means judgment has been passed upon them and a sentence given, and now they have to pay that penalty for what they've done. For me to have no condemnation, it isn't just when I got saved. Here's what people think. I get saved, there's no condemnation. I'm walking through my Christian life. Oop, I fell into sin. I'm not condemned. I'm condemned again. I'm condemned again. We come and we pray our little prayer. Oh, I'm not condemned. Until we trip into a sin. Oh, I'm condemned again. I'm condemned. Listen, that's junk. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. If you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you're not condemned anymore. There is no judgment going to come on you. You know why? Because the judgment went on Jesus Christ on the cross. And when God looks at us, he doesn't want sacrifice. He gives us mercy. And that mercy that's given, do we deserve mercy?
No.
No. Wait, did you not sing that song the other morning?
Yeah.
Mercy walked in and pleaded my case and called to the stand. God saving grace.
Amen.
Oh, son, I'm telling you, we got to get understanding of when you put your faith in Jesus, he didn't come into the world to condemn the world. He come into the world to save us. Now look at the next verse. And with that understanding, he that believeth on him is not condemned. Those sitting at the table, they were publicans and sinners. But he didn't come. He didn't come to judge the sinners. He came to save them. Judgment is what condemnation is. Listen, Jesus doesn't make us a sinner. God's word doesn't make me a sinner. It just teaches me I am one. And once I see it, it teaches me and brings understanding. It's my schoolmaster to bring me unto Christ, and it teaches me you're a sinner.
Yeah.
As Jesus was sitting with this group, he said, I didn't come into the world to condemn it. I come into the world to save it. The Pharisees look down their nose and says, I want you to look at that. Look. Jesus is sitting there. He knows what they're thinking. He said, look, it's not the righteous. Or he said, it ain't the well. It's the sick. They're the ones that needs a physician. I've never one time in my life went to the doctor healthy. I'm always feeling bad. Matter of fact, when I get there, he's like, you better get in here. Because he knows I hate going to the doctor. And I've told him before. Look, Dr. Horton, I hate coming to the doctor. And if I come to you, you better know I'm sick. All right? I'm not just coming just to hang out. I'm sick. Jesus was making known to them, this group of sinners, they're sick. Jesus was the physician.
Amen.
And he says, I have the ability to heal them that they will no longer be condemned ever again. Verse 18, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Listen, here's the thing that gets me. The religious rulers of the day were the Pharisees and scribes. They're the ones that's got a problem with it. And do you realize, every one of them sitting around that table, Zacchaeus, that little wee little man, and he says, Zacchaeus, you come down, I'm going to your house today. Guess what? He left and became more righteous than the most fancy, little phylactery wearing, loud praying on the corner, money chucking in the plate where everybody can see him, fasting in the public and frowning all over their face so somebody would say, what's the matter? Oh, I'm fasting today. Ooh, he's religious. That's what they got. They got their reward.
That's right.
But Jesus come that they might have life.
More abundantly.
And they might have it more abundantly.
Hey.
Now, I'll share this with you. I told you I was going to a minute ago when I did. It is so easy. Somehow. And I think as the older I get, I'm starting, it's just like the Lord starts showing me these things. And it's like, why has this always been an issue? It's really easy to see certain folks and immediately in my mind, you know what I think? Bunch of sinners. They ain't right. Why not? Because if they was right, they'd have time. That's why. I'm telling you, and I'm thinking to myself, why has people entertained that thought? Why? Matter of fact, if you go back here, this group sitting around the table with sinners, and guess what? They all probably had tunics on. Where did this come from? Where did it come from? Somehow we have got into this Pharisaical thing that you just got to, here's what you got to look like. Or you're not just right. Well, that's not so. Because I've had people look like that before. And they were the most miserable, hateful, unloving. Oh man, it was horrible. Horrible. And I've seen other folks that would be frowned upon, and they would be the most giving, loving, gentle, caring, God-loving, scripture-reading, Bible-studying person I've ever been around in my life. I share that to say this. I think we should wear our best. But when our best becomes our judgment to pick on whether or not somebody's right or not, I can't see their heart. And I'm telling you, it's the sinners, according to this Matthew chapter 9 passage. The sick are the ones that need a physician. And these ones, sometimes I suppose it's evident they're sick. They need help. Have you ever tried to get somebody to go to the doctor that didn't want to go? And you tried to. And you knew they needed to go. And you knew they were sick. Literally, you took their temperature. It's 103.7. And you're like, I'm telling you, honey, you got to go to the doctor. I ain't going. You got to go to the doctor. I ain't going. 103.9. Oh my goodness, you got... I ain't going. Here's the thing. When we're lost in sin, we'll do everything in the world to keep from coming to the physician. But you know what I can't do? I can't make you.
That's right.
We can't make one another. You can't make your loved one, family member, neighbor. We can't make anybody. All we can do is share the love of Jesus with them and the gospel.
Yep.
And that gospel seed that we're sowing, once it lands on good ground, it can come and be taken. And it'll take root